Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear brothers and my sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdusalam, Abu Hanifa. As Ramadan is drawing near, we need to get ready. Not that this is the first Ramadan ever, but you have had so many in the past, and you would think like we would learn from them. But by the amount of questions asked by people, it looks like Ramadan is always a new visitor. It's always a newcomer. As I mentioned before, there is always a great deal in understanding why that act of ritual has been named as such. For example, when we say ash-shahada, or bearing the testimony, what does that mean? Well, as you know, to be able to witness something, you have to be physically present there, and you also have to be emotionally and mentally present there. Otherwise, you cannot be a witness. So when you say ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, what you are saying is that in full of my capacity as a human being, and also intellectually and emotionally, I am present as I utter that I do bear witness that Allah is one and that Muhammad is his messenger. And also when you look at the salah comes from the root word of silah, and that is the relationship between you and somebody else. The zakat is elevating one's status and soul purification. So as you can see that by understanding just the name, you are actually setting yourself on the right track to practicing that act of worship as it ought to be. Al-Hajj, for example, is setting on a journey to a sacred and venerated place to carry on some rituals. To get a good understanding about the name of Ramadan, I strongly encourage you to listen to my other talks about Ramadan, where I explain what the word Ramadan means and all. But this talk here is about the fiqh, the things that we should do and shouldn't do in Ramadan, and certain things that are related to Ramadan. I have designed this pep talk here so that you can listen to it and really enjoy it with your kids. It's not a dry fiqh topic, but it's more on the practicalities of the month. And inshallah, with it and your notes that you're going to take, you'll be able to cruise through Ramadan with no troubles at all. Well, our guest is Ramadan. The name of this guest is Ramadan. He is the 9th kid in a 12 siblings family. I.e. in the lunar family, he is the 9th kid. And as such, he is not a stable month in that he moves, because the lunar months, they move based on the moon's motion. And it is about 10 days shorter than the solar ones. Sometimes it comes in winter and sometimes it comes in summer, sometimes in spring and fall and all these things. He is a time traveler. Sometimes if you live long enough, you will fast it in winter and you will fast it again in summer. To know what Ramadan, as I said, means, you really need to listen to my dedicated talks on the subject. They are on YouTube. So my dear brothers and my sisters, when Ramadan visits us, it brings with it a list of orders and also a list of rewards. And these rewards have goodies, direct and indirect goodies. Some physicals, other emotionals, and some spirituals, and some you will find on the day of Al-Qiyamah. Ramadan always comes with gifts. Some can be seen right here, right there and then. But many can't be visually perceived, yet the impact of Ramadan's gifts travels with us through space and time. Ramadan, as I said, comes with so many different functions. And the very first thing, or the very first function that our guest does, is to regulate our time. He splits it into two parts, daytime and nighttime. And if only we could keep that division after it leaves, we would have a good life all around. Since our guest divides our time into two parts, let's then see what it has for us in both times. And I will start here by the daytime. As you have guessed, when Ramadan comes in daytime, it brings with it a series of commands. These commands are clear, crystal clear. And here they are one after the other. The number one is, Ramadan comes with credentials. Any month could have claimed the same privileges as Ramadan, to be fasted in, etc. But Ramadan comes with a series of definite, believable, and absolute identification that no other month possesses. First of which, what makes it special? Ramadan is directly introduced to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And before making Ramadan the container of different rituals, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pointed us to the top of its achievements. And these are achievements of Ramadan. It is a time container which Allah chose to send down His final book to the best place and to the best race of creation, and that is mankind. Allah says, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنَ. The month of Ramadan is the month in which Al-Quran was descended from heavens to the first heaven of the earth. The second credential of this month is that we have received direct divine orders to mark this month. So after introducing Ramadan to us, and after highlighting the major event that occurred during this month, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered and orders us to celebrate the month in a very particular manner. If left to mankind, my dear brothers and my sisters, we would have organized festivals, fanfares, musical concerts, rallies, activities for kids, holidays, etc. But Allah orders us that which is best to mankind in the long run, for here in this life and later on when the world comes to an end. Just like you, a parent, knows what is best for your child, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what is best for us human beings. He knows it and knows it what is even better for us than ourselves. And Ramadan comes with a special order, and that is abstination, the saum, the fast. During its days, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمَهُ. Therefore, whoever of you witnesses the month, let them fast it. Ramadan's third credential is it's a special place in the life of the Prophet ﷺ. Since its inception in year 2, after the migration of Rasulullah ﷺ, Ramadan was incepted on Sha'ban of the year 2, and that is 15 years since the birth of Islam. Muslims didn't have much time to observe Ramadan. It was in Sha'ban. A few days later, Ramadan was here, and they started fasting straight there and then. As such, the Prophet ﷺ fasted 9 Ramadans, and whenever Ramadan was close or witnessed, he ﷺ would mark it with the most and highest of practices to mark it as great as Allah wants it. Ramadan is considered also as the month of revelations. In a hadith considered weak by many scholars and good by so many other scholars, of them is Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani, this hadith is reported by Imam Ahmad al-Bayhaqi and al-Tabarani. It is said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith, the meaning of which is, أُنزِلَتْ صُحُفُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ فِي أَوَّلِ لَيْلَةٍ مِنْ رَمَضَانِ. The scriptures of Abraham were revealed or were descended in the first night of Ramadan. وَأُنزِلَتِ التَّوْرَاتُ لِسِتٍ مَضَيْنَ مِنْ رَمَضَانِ. And the Torah were revealed unto Musa 6 nights have gone after the beginning of Ramadan. وَالْإِنْجِيلِ لِثَلَاثَةَ عَشْرَةَ خَلَتْ مِنْ رَمَضَانِ. And the Gospel was revealed 13 nights after the beginning of Ramadan. وَأُنزِلَ الْفُرْقَانُ لِأَرْبَعٍ وَعِشْرِينَ خَلَتْ مِنْ رَمَضَانِ. And the Furqan, the divider, the Qur'an, i.e., was revealed in the day or the night of the 25th of Ramadan. And as I said, this hadith was classified good by some scholars and weak by others. In any case, it's just a piece of information. It actually does absolutely nothing to believe or not to believe in. But I thought it's just kind of like a piece of information in case you hear this hadith some other days. Remember at the beginning, I said that Ramadan splits our time into two distinct compartments, day and night. And as I mentioned earlier on in this pep talk here, I will speak about the daytime, and inshallah, in the next one, I will speak about the nighttime. I will mention 15 points that, bi'idhnillah, will cover everything that you need to know about Ramadan. Since we are speaking about the daytime, let's see how we can figure out the length of the daytime. Always remember that Al-Quran doesn't talk to people in a particular land, or especially in Muslim land. It talks to mankind as a whole. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks to mankind, He will set the beginning and the end of the day in a manner that everyone on earth will be able to figure out the beginning on the end. After all, you might have a watch on your wrist now, but somewhere deep in the farthest part in the world, somewhere in the Amazon jungle, there are some people that are so primitive that they are still counting on the rising and the fall of the sun. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَكُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ ثُمَّ أَتِمُّوا الصِّيَامَ إِلَى اللَّيْلِ. And this is Al-Baqarah, this is the second surah, ayah 187, where Allah says in the meaning here in my translation, and eat and drink until the white thread becomes distinct to you from the black thread of the Fajr, i.e. when the night is completely dark, as the sun starts rising and the dawn starts breaking, you will start seeing a thread of light. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls it the white thread from the Fajr. Then when you see that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we must stop from eating and complete the fasting until the night time. If one lived outside the artificially lit cities that we live in, like London or New York or whatever, then it would be easy to figure out these threads. But because we live in a city, it is absolutely difficult for us to find out when the true day breaks in and when the true night falls. But if the clarity was there, we could rely just by looking at the skies. But this is not possible. This is why we resort to our watches. And we count on observatories to tell us exactly when the sun rises and when the sun sets. And that's how using timings has come to our rescue and is making it easy for us today. So to know exactly when the day, always do one of the two things. One, pick up your daily or the monthly Ramadan timetable. And don't take them for granted. Go on the internet to your local observatory country and figure out when the sun rises truly and when it sets truly. Compare the two and work out a safe measure. So, for example, yeah, if your home lane says that Fajr is at 3 o'clock and you go to your website, to the government website, and it says it's at 3:15, I would go with the 3:15. And then I figure out how I can run my day and my night based on that timing there. But this is just to give me an appreciation and an indication of the two timings together, so I get an average and work with it. Since the daytime is our field of action until the fall of night, so let's see what divine orders are to be observed in the first bracket of the day. Because what we can do in daytime, we cannot do at night time. First, what does the term sawm mean? People say fast, but in English, fasting, it could be withholding from food, or you can drive your car fast, or you can fasten your seat belt. But in Arabic, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the term sawm, it has a particular meaning. That meaning is withholding from doing something, anything. So if you are staying at home and you don't want to talk to somebody, if someone walks into the room and talks to you and you don't want to respond back to them, so all you got to do is say, I am fasting, ana sa'im. And if they ask from food, you go, no, of speech. So you are fasting or not speaking. And this is exactly what happened to our mother, Mary, alayhi salam, when she gave birth to Jesus. The people of her time, the Jews, the children of Israel at that time, there had already canned accusations. They started accusing her of fornication, of a lot of things. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took it upon himself, Ar-Rahman, to defend her. So when they came and started throwing accusations to her, how come you did this, daughter, sister of Harun, your mother was not a prostitute, and your father was not this and was not that, how can you give a birth, what did you do? So she turned to them and she said, إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ لِلرَّحْمَانِ صَوْمًا فَلَنْ أُكَلِّمَ الْيَوْمَ إِنْسِيَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had commanded her to, when she sees the people, that she says, I have vowed to Ar-Rahman, which is the name of Allah, Ar-Rahman, a sawm, a fast. So, and then Allah explained what that fast was. I will not speak today to any human. And then she pointed to Jesus, son of Mary, and he started talking on her behalf. Therefore, sawm as a whole, fast, what is in English, means abstinence. But abstinence from what exactly? Well, as it turns out, the first one, abstinence, is the food and drinks. And this is known by everybody out there. And simply put, you are not allowed to intake or swallow any types of foods, drinks. And this includes cakes, sweets, chewing gums, candy, sweets, everything. As for drinks, it's water, fizzy drinks, soft drinks, protein drinks, and anything. What this means is the pipe that leads from your mouth to your stomach must remain inactive throughout the day. Nothing should go through it except your own saliva. The number two forbidden act is the sexual intercourse. And by sexual intercourse, it means the penetration. Anything less than that is fine. Making out, kissing, touching, all those things are fine as long as they don't lead to a deliberate ejaculation. Otherwise, penetration is not permitted. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أُحِلَّ لَكُمْ لَيْلَةَ الصِّيَامِ الرَّفَثُ إِلَى نِسَائِكُمْ. It has been made halal for you in the night of the fast to have sexual relationship with your wives. And this means that during daytime, it is not permitted. So as you can see here, Allah has explained in Surah Al-Baqarah, which is Surah number 2, Ayah 187, هُنَّ لِبَاسٌ لَكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ لِبَاسٌ لَهُنْ. For they are garments to you, and you are garments to them, i.e. beautification, protection, sensations, and all that kind of stuff. Until he says, فَالْآنَ بَاشِرُهُنَّ وَابْتَغُوا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. Therefore now sleep with them and seek that which Allah has written for you, i.e. in the night of Ramadan. And from here, alhamdulillah, our Prophet ﷺ, and thereafter that, everybody agreed that sexual, deliberate sexual intercourse will break your fast and will get you in hot waters with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I will speak later on about the undeliberate ones. As I have already mentioned, deliberate sexual intercourse breaks the fast, and if any of the two partners want to have sex, for example, the husband or the wife, the other partner must not yield. They must not accept and go along with it. They must remind the other person. They must run away. They must not be part in the crime of breaking a day in Ramadan. The third prohibition is smoking cigarettes and drugs intake. And drugs intake could be smoking cannabis or marijuana and to crack cocaine, either sniffing or smoking it through a pipe or injecting it. My dear brothers and my sisters, this is an epidemic and you must stop this. Smoking is not permitted. And intaking drugs is also a major sin. And if someone dies due to an overdose of drugs, it is a suicide. It is a suicide. But again, these drugs here, irrelevant on how they are taken, they will break the fast of the person. Point number four, injections. When you go to the hospital and you need to inject something, that something could be a cortisone needle or an antibiotic or insulin or something of that thing. When Ibn Uthaymeen alayhi rahmatullah was asked about the injections, he said, injections simply fall into two categories, the nutritious ones and the not nutritious one. And he said, if the nutritious ones are intaken, they will break the fast because it is they are food and they are drinks. But if they are not nutritious and they are used to fight a disease, then they are not nutritious. As such, they don't break the fast. So if somebody goes to the hospital because of a cortisone shot or antibiotics or some kind of medication taken through injections through veins, then it is not a problem. So I will repeat, if the injection is nutritious, it breaks the fast. If it is not nutritious, it doesn't break the fast. Point number five, hijama, vomit, and putting on makeup. There are no evidences that prohibit hijama in the month of Ramadan. There is nothing in the Quran, and anything that is mentioned in a hadith is either weak, fabricated, but nothing of it is authentic. When people want to prohibit hijama, they will quote a hadith reported by Abu Dawud and others, أفطر الحاجم والمحجوم. Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah spoke about this. He said, this is a hadith that I spent a long time trying to understand. Okay, if the mahjoom is the one who has the hijama, breaks the fast, why is the one that does it also breaks its fast? And then he said, because at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the hijama was that it was sucked through the mouth. So the person who does the hijama will suck out the blood from the other person. However, this hadith, as I said, is a weak hadith and cannot be held as an evidence. So if you want to have hijama in Ramadan, just make sure that you take the precautions so that it does not affect your fasting. As for the vomiting, it all depends if the vomit goes back to the stomach or not. If it does go back to the stomach, then it breaks it. If it doesn't, then it shouldn't and it mustn't. There is a hadith by Abu Huraira, but that hadith has been deemed weak and cannot be used as an evidence. As Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani alayhi rahmatullah in Talkhis al-Habir said that it is not authentic, and that is also the understanding of al-Imam al-Bukhari alayhi rahmatullah. So if you vomit, just make sure you don't swallow it back again. If you don't, then your fast is fine. If you do, then it will break your fast. If it is an undeliberate vomit, then you should go on fasting the day and make it up another day. But if it's a deliberate one, then you must repent to Allah because you have committed a sin. You must carry on fasting that day and remake it another day. When it comes now to putting on makeup, there are absolutely no evidences at all that say that your fast is broken or not valid, including putting on perfume and everything that you can do. So that is fine as well. I'm not encouraging you to go out with the makeup, but just in case you have that issue or you want to put it at home. Point number 6, and that is kissing between partners, married partners, and gargling water. Kissing one's spouses on the lips with or without passion, with or without arousal, does not affect the fast in any way. Even if there is an erection or a pre-sperm coming out, it won't affect your fasting, and the same thing for women as well. And what I mean kissing includes everything, foreplay, that is fine. But again, you gotta make sure that it doesn't lead to the act of penetration, because that will break your fast and that will make it haram on you. Sheikh al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah has a very long fatwa in Arabic about undeliberate ejaculations and arousals in Ramadan, the summary of which is it doesn't break the fast. Perhaps one day I will deal with this issue here. But this is just a quick guide to what is and what is not allowed during the daytime in Ramadan. And since I am at it, also wet dreams when you sleep, when you are sleeping daytime and you see yourself having sex in your dreams and you ejaculate, that does not break your fast. All you have to do is go take a ghusl and carry on your fast. You don't even need to make it up, because that is an involuntary act and it's not a deliberate act. You just, even if you think about it and all that kind of stuff, that is fine, as long as you are not doing it. The point is to doing it physically. As for gargling water or testing the soup or washing and brushing one's teeth, it also does not affect your fast at all. The tongue is an external part of the body. Just like when you make wudu, you gargle water, you wash your mouth, it doesn't break it. If my sister, you are cooking and you want to taste the food, is it salty, is not, it's good, is not, you can do that. Also, you can brush your teeth and you can taste the toothpaste. It doesn't break your fast at all. Always bear in mind these rules. As long as it doesn't travel to your stomach, alhamdulillah, you are in safe hand. Your mouth, the internal of your mouth, is considered as an external part of your body. It's like touching the toothpaste with your hand. It just happens that our tongue picks up on the tastes, but it doesn't mean we have eaten it. Point number 7, and that is food and drinks due to forgetfulness. One of the great news one can find in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, amongst many others, is the promise made to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that forgetfulness and indeliberate acts are not counted against us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah at the end of it, ayah 286, رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَخِذْنَا إِن نَسِيْنَا أَوْ أَخْطَأْنَا. Ya Allah, our Rabb, our Lord, do not blame us if we forget or made mistakes. And as such, if you eat and you are in the state of forgetfulness and you drink and you have a whole meal and thinking like normal days, and then at the end of it, you figure out that, Ya Allah, I've had a big lunch in the midst of Ramadan, then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, based on that ayah, brings the good news to you, and he says, "Man nasiya wa huwa sa'imun fa akala wa sharab." Whoever has forgotten while in the state of fasting, and they ate and drank, falyutimma sawmah, let them carry on with their fast. فَإِنَّمَا أَطْعَمَهُ اللَّهُ وَسَقَاهُ, is Allah who has fed him and quenched their thirst. And this hadith is in al-Bukhari and Muslim. So if you forget, then it's no problem at all. Actually, the books of fiqh always have this funny story. It's a very good story. A man bought some grapes, 1 kilogram of grapes, and was going home. And he was eating the grapes one after one, and he completely forgot it was Ramadan. And at the end, so he ate the whole kilogram of it. And then at the last grape, he remembered that, Ya Allah, this is Ramadan, and I've eaten a whole kilogram, and I've only got this one left. And then he said, well, if I've eaten the whole thing, let me add this one and I finish it off the whole kilogram. And then the scholar said, this man lost his day, not because he ate the almost 1 kg, but because he ate the one left. The 1 kg, he did them in forgetfulness. But the one he ate, the last one, was he did it in deliberate act, and he was not forgetting, and that act was a deliberate act, and it broke his fast. So don't worry if you forget, it's absolutely fine, especially day one, no problem at all. Point number 8, the pregnant and the breastfeeder. Again, this beautiful religion, my dear sisters, truly came to help humans get the best out of this life and maximize for the other life. Al-Islam prides itself in easiness. And whenever there is hardship, you can rest assured someone has taken the wrong turn in understanding the divine texts. After all, Allah explicitly mentioned in the Quran, هُوَ اجْتَبَاكُمْ وَمَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجٍ. It is Allah who has chosen you and has not placed upon you in the deen, in this set of laws, i.e. Islam, any difficulties. And this is in Surah Al-Hajj 22:78. And pay attention how Allah said this ayah in Surah Al-Hajj, which is the most difficult act of worship, even that there is no hardship in it for us. And as such, if a pregnant lady or a breastfeeder find difficulties while fasting, then they can opt to eat and drink to secure their well-being. Their status is as close as that of a sick person. They must not injure or hurt themselves or their babies. As usual, the scholars have debated the issue of paying the fidya, ransom, or just make up the days, i.e. if a mother, a breastfeeder, or a pregnant woman find in the day of Ramadan that she cannot fast. So, can she just eat that day and make it up another day? Or can she eat on that day and feed a poor person and then make it up on the other day? So the scholars have debated this issue, should she or should she not, and the strong opinion and the correct one is to just eat on that day and make it up another day. Don't you just love this religion? It's beautiful. Now, who can decide what is hardship and what is not? Each human being knows their limit. What's hardship to me may not be to you, and what's hardship to you may not be hardship to somebody else. Don't rely on other people to tell you what's hardship. You are the judge on yourself. I can or I cannot do. So if you are pregnant and it's difficult for you, eat and make it up another day. And if you are breastfeeder, the same thing. If it's difficult for you or for your child, then eat and make it up another day and say Alhamdulillah for this easiness. Point number 9, starting your day, your Ramadan day, in a sexual state, i.e. after you've had your suhoor with your wife and then you two had sex together, you slept together, and before you had opportunity, the adhan is called. And then after the adhan is finished, you go and you take your ghusl. So if the adhan is called and you haven't taken your ghusl, it does not affect your fasting at all. Even if you take, say Fajr is at 4 o'clock and you woke up at 4:30, the fact that you woke up in a sexual impurity does not affect your fast at all. Our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, as in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, and so is our mother Salama, the two wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they said that أَنَّ النَّبِيَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ كَانَ يُصْبِحُ جُنُوبًا مِنْ جِمَاعٍ غَيْرَ احْتِلَامٍ ثُمَّ يَصُومُ فِي رَمَضَانٍ. That Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to get up in the morning, wake up with janaba, i.e. sexual impurity, not because of a daydream, i.e. he slept with his wives, and that didn't affect his fast. He would just make a ghusl and would go and do his salat sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Point number 10, the suhoor. The suhoor is not part of Ramadan. And what I mean by that, it's not needed for the validity of your fast. You do suhoor or you don't do suhoor, that is absolutely independent from your Ramadan. The suhoor is the small meal you have before you start your day of fast. And it's just normal, it's just reasonable that you eat before you start a day of fasting. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, تَسَحَّرُ فَإِنَّ فِي السَّحُورِ بَرَكَةً. Eat your suhoor, for there is a barakah. And barakah here means a great good. And that great good is that your body starts the day with a lot of energy to burn later on. And this is in Al-Bukhari and Muslim. So if you don't wake up for suhoor, and you wake up after the time of suhoor has gone, it doesn't affect your fast in any way at all. But if you woke up, for example, and the adhan is being called and it is halfway through, and you have and you want to drink something, yes, you can eat it or drink it at that moment there. For Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِذَا سَمِعَ أَحَدُكُمُ النِّدَاءِ, if one of you hears the nida, i.e. the adhan, وَالْإِنَاءُ عَلَى يَدِهِ, and he has a pot or drink or plate in his hand, فَلَا يَضَعْهُ, let him not put it down, حَتَّى يَقْضِيَ حَاجَتَهُ مِنْ, until he finishes his food. Even Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah, in our days and before him, some scholars, they said, if you are having your suhoor, you started having your suhoor and the adhan starts making, they said you should eat as the adhan is being made and you should carry on eating until you finish what you have put on the table. Obviously, it's not like a 3 hours eat, but sometimes you put a bowl of cereals and it takes you another 5 minutes after the adhan, in which case, yes, you can go and eat that too. And I do that personally. If I am eating something and the adhan calls, I don't stop from eating until I finish what's on my table. And then I go wash my my mouth and get ready for my salat. Don't you just love this religion? Subhanallah. It's not about getting us hungry all the time. It's more so to prepare us for higher purpose. In point number 11, I will speak about the fasting concessions, about Ramadan, the concessions that you can have. And I will start with old people. If a person is old, very old, and cannot fast due to age and physical weakness, in this case here, this person should feed a poor person instead. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, as Abdullah ibn Abbas said, وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ يُطِيقُونَهُ فِدْيَةٌ طَعَامٌ مِسْكِينٌ, and for those who can fast it, they must pay a ransom, and that is to feed a poor person. And this means that, this is reported also by Al-Bukhari alayhi rahmatullah, and as I said, narrated by Abdullah ibn Abbas. And this means, like, if you have a father who is 86, and he's frail and weak, and Ramadan comes in, then all you gotta do is find out how much it would cost to feed a poor on a single day. And I'm gonna take the example here in England, let's say it's £5 a day. So if my father was an old man, then I would do like this. I would count the 30 days. At £5 a day, that gives me £150. And in which case here, I will make sure that I feed a poor every single day. You go to the masjid or you go, you take your own route to finding these poor people and they are around. Just make sure it's for food. Don't give £150 to somebody and they go buy a new phone. It has to be it'amu miskin, ta'am miskin, that is, you have to feed a poor person. Don't give them just the money, ensure that they eat it. Another class of citizens of Islam that are entitled to concessions are the sick people. And the ayah says, فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَىٰ سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ, so whoever of you is ill or on a trip, then an equal number of days, i.e. you make up an equal number of days later on. As usual, again, the scholars debated this ayah. Some added more conditions to the ayah, as it is always the case. It never is what Allah said is enough. They always had to add something to make it more difficult. But the literalists took it as it is. Whenever someone is sick or on a trip, the concession applies, and this is the authentic point of view, as Allah says it. And this is what I go for personally. As such, each person is a judge on themselves. If a sick person is temporary, then the person can break their fast and make it up at a later date. When to make it up, it's entirely up to you. But just make sure you don't leave it till the next Ramadan or miss a Ramadan and still you have days that you haven't fasted. And I will speak later on about this case here. So here the case is the sick person is that they are sick in Ramadan. Let's say you have a flu or a cold or you have some pain or some whatever it is and you need to take your medication. So when you take the medication, take it. And then count down the number of days and make it up later on. You have that concession there and then. What I mentioned is temporary sickness. But what about the permanent sickness? So if a person has a permanent sickness or is dependent on daily medication to stay well and are, as a result of that, unable to observe fast, then they are entitled to not fast. And instead, they must feed a poor person for every single day that they don't fast. It's exactly like the old people. They can't fast, they feed, and alhamdulillah. I come now to speak about making up the missed days. If a person must make up for a number of days, then they can choose when. Some scholars have demanded that the days must be done one after the other in one go. However, the majority is of the opinion that the person is totally free to refast them as they please. You can fast them all in a matter in December when the day starts at 8 o'clock in the morning and ends at 2 p.m. And you can fast them together or separate, because Allah mentioned فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says then a number of days, but He didn't specify either they should be together or separate. And people here, subhanAllah, they say the best thing to not do something is to leave it open. I.e., if you lend a book to somebody, if you want it back, tell them, I want it back in 1 week's time. But if you want to never see your book again, is tell them, take it and bring it back when you're finished with it. You can rest assured, most of the time you'll never see your book again. So when it comes to making up the days, people, subhanAllah, have delayed. And I get a lot of questions. I have 2 Ramadans, I haven't fasted. 3 Ramadans, I haven't fasted. So here is what is the ruling on these issues. Any missed days, either the menstruations or travels or sickness or pregnancy or breastfeeding or any kind of days that you have missed, they must be repaid back. It's a debt in your neck. A normal dedicated Muslim would fast these days before the next Ramadan, and this is the norm. But lots of Muslims are extremely lazy, and when it comes to paying back these days, people split into 3 categories. Category number 1, those who owe days and have paid them before the coming of the next Ramadan. These are the champions and they'll be highly rewarded. Number 2, or category number 2, those who owe days but their payment is hindered by continuous sickness or a status. For example, a woman who is pregnant and then she gives birth, and then straight away she gets pregnant and she gives birth. So she's got a valid excuse as to why she didn't repay back her days, missed days. In this case here, she will need to repay them as soon as she is able to and not delay them. Category number 3, and this is the majority of people, and this is for those who owe days, but their laziness got the best of them. And 11 months were not enough for them to make those missed days back. And Ramadan comes, and suddenly they start panicking like a headless chicken. What should I do? What should I do? And then many of them, what they say is, let this Ramadan pass, and then I will fast them again. And this Ramadan passes, and in most cases, those days are still not made up. In this case here, what is the ruling for these people? Number 1, the people who could have fasted but didn't fast, they will have sinned. Every day that goes by, those days will yield you sins. And Ramadan comes, you fast Ramadan. Then the quicker you make them virtually, is the best for you. And the more you delay, it's an unnecessary sin that you are getting for not paying back those days. So if you have not made up those days, you wanna do it and do it quick. Ramadan is coming, do as many as you can now. And fast Ramadan, and then after Ramadan, do them again. After all, it's a concession by Allah given to you. Don't abuse it, use it. Point number 13, when to start fasting? When or who do we follow to start Ramadan? It seems every year Muslims face the same monster questions that never get answered. When does Ramadan start? Which country should we follow, Saudi Arabia or which? The Islamic centers in the UK follow different countries. Which then should we follow? How come Muslims can't unify over Ramadan? These and many other questions get asked every single year. And the problem is our lack of knowledge. In normal circumstances, Muslims go back to the book of Allah first, then the Sunnah of Rasulullah the second, the Sunnah that goes with the book hand in hand. Allah made it clear in Al-Quran, فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرِ فَلْيَصُمَهُ. So whoever cites the first moon of the month must fast it. What this means is each country is responsible to eyesight its moon. But since technology today has come and they see a nearby country that has seen the moon, we can choose to fast. But predominantly, look where you live. In London here, let's say you live in Finsbury or you live in Fulham or you live in wherever you live, As soon as your local Islamic center says that Ramadan is on that day, fast with your local Islamic center. Don't fast with the one that is 600 miles away. That is why Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says in the hadith, "Sumu li ru'yatihi," i.e. sumu when you see the moon of the crescent of Ramadan. Wa aftiru li ru'yatihi, and you break the iftar Ramadan when you see it also, the moon. فَإِذَا غُبِّيَ عَلَيْكُمْ, and if it has been covered because of the clouds, فَعُدُّوا ثَلَاثِينَ يَوْمًا, so you count 30 days. Sadly, these days, the problem as it has always been is when politics rule Islam, when politics control Islam. So many countries today don't want to fast because this or that country, which they don't get along with, have started fasting on that day. And this is like a big, huge calamity. But as a whole, wherever you are, that's who you should fast with. Point number 14, the intention to fast. And I left this towards the end so that it stays fresh in your mind. No act can be carried out without a prior intent. And this I speak about any act. Even sitting down to do nothing comes because of an intent to do so. Therefore, our job is to direct that intent and make it the motivator, the main motivating factor to obey the orders of Allah. And that's how you get rewards. Don't just fast Ramadan because people are fasting, because Ramadan is coming. No, fast Ramadan because it's a command of Allah, because it is what Allah has said to us. Do it as a sign of obedience, not as a sign of habit. Because doing an act out of yourself or doing the same act as an obedience act yields different rewards. And I'll give you an example. If you ask your child to clean their room and they obey and go and do it, it's completely different than when you ask them to do the room, they disobey you and then they ignore you, and later on out of themselves they decide to clean the room. In the second one, it doesn't register well with you because they have disobeyed and now they're doing it out of themselves, and there is a hidden message there, and that message is, I don't obey you. And to Allah is the highest of the examples. So when Allah says you fast Ramadan, it must be deep inside you that you do it as a sign of obedience and you obey on His terms and conditions, not on your terms and conditions. Look at Shaitan. He was ordered to carry a divine order. He disobeyed and refused. While you are ordered to carry a divine order, and that is the fasting of Ramadan, and you obliged and obeyed. For this, Allah will not fail you when it comes to your reward. A shaitan was commanded to prostrate for a few minutes, most. And he refused, and he paid with it, with all his life and his eternity. And you are commanded to fast 30 days, and you obeyed. What do you think of the reward? This is why the reward of fasting, only Allah knows it, because no human being can comprehend how much reward you are going to get for leaving out the essentials of your life, food, drink, and sex. These are built within us. Without them, humanity would not exist. You have left the ultimate for Allah, and Allah will give you the highest of rewards that you can ever dream of. And I am awaiting on the day of Qiyamah to see how much goodies are there awaiting for me, for you, and for everyone else. Intending your act is greatly praised in Al-Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says at the end of Surah Al-Kahf, فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ, therefore, whosoever is hoping to meet in his Lord, فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا, let him do a righteous deed, وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا, and not associate by his act of worship with his Lord anyone else. And these two conditions are what forms your act. You must do an act of goodness and you must do it for the sake of Allah. You cannot disobey Allah and say, like some people, they steal money and they say, I steal money to donate as charity. No, the stealing is haram, even if your intention is good. So that action of giving the excuse, oh, my heart is good, doesn't mean like that. The act has to be good and accepted to Allah, And your intention has to be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to yield the reward. Point number 15, and I will close my talk with this number 15 here, that Ramadan is not a lazy month. Muslims today are the worst ambassadors of Islam in general, and Ramadan in particular. It really is strange that in the daytime when Ramadan comes in, everything in the Muslim world almost comes to an halt. Offices are up late, people are functioning at less than quarters of their energy, and everything that goes wrong is passed onto the account of Ramadan. So much so that schools here in England and the West, when Ramadan comes, they start propagating that Ramadan is not good for intelligence, for the energy, for this, and that is because of the information and the vision and the ideas we give to the West about this. Many times I've heard people in the West saying, oh, it's Ramadan and Muslims don't work full days. Basically, it's laziness all the way through. In England, schools treat Ramadan as a weakener. Some children are even scared of fasting, and the school pushes this agenda. Ramadan, my dear sisters and my brothers, is not a month of laziness, nor it is a month of anger and fight. Some people, they straight away when Ramadan comes, they are on a state of war. Don't talk to me, I am fasting, they will yell at you. In the masjid, people struggle and fight and all these things. And subhanAllah al-Haq, as if Ramadan, instead of being the month of greatness on how we take the exam and move on forward, like that heavy rock you attach to somebody's ankles with chains as you drop them in an ocean. Ramadan is not like this. And on the day of Al-Qiyamah, Allah will ask us questions as to why we have portrayed Ramadan to the world as the month of laziness, stupidity, ignorance, weakness, and all these kinds of things. Ramadan is not like that at all. After all, people don't eat all the time. When armies are in fight and trainings, soldiers are trained not to eat a lot. Have you ever seen a fat soldier? They are always trim and things like that, and great people and all these things. I don't know why we Muslims, we always portray Ramadan as the month of starvation. Proof, look at what you eat at night. But in any case, this is the daytime about Ramadan. Please, please, please ensure that your Ramadan gets to the maximum. Inshallah, in the next pep talk, I will speak about the evening time and what it is we should do. And I will cover a few issues and a few things to maximize our intake from Ramadan and also to maximize our understanding on what is and what is not permitted at night. This is again your brother Abdusalam Abu Hanifa. To be part of the group, just send me a message on WhatsApp. Telephone number is 0044-7876-408735. I wish you all a wonderful Ramadan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.